Hi, Mud Fam. This is Sarah Russell, your Mud Water podcast host, here with another conversation full of curiosity, this time with Jesse Gould. Jesse Gould is a former Army Ranger, ultra runner, and a pioneer in psychedelic therapies for veterans. As founder and president of the Heroic Hearts Project, he has spearheaded the research and acceptance of ayahuasca, ibogaine, ketamine, and psilocybin therapy programs for military veterans. Jesse has connected hundreds of veterans to psychedelic treatments, partnered with the world's leading psychedelic centers, and is researching psychiatric applications with the University of Georgia, the University of Texas, Austin Dell Medical School, and Imperial College of London. His mission is to help military veterans struggling with mental trauma and spread awareness of the benefits that psychedelic therapies offer as alternative treatment to pharmaceuticals. Jesse has spoken globally about the benefits of psychedelics on mental health and has been featured in the New York Times, The New Yorker, The Economist, and Forbes, and is recognized as one of the most influential voices in psychedelics today. To date, Heroic Hearts Project has raised over $5 million and has served over 450 veterans and military spouses through psychedelic therapies. Hi, Jesse. Welcome to the pod.
Hi, Sarah. Thanks so much for having me.
I would love to hear about the Heroic Hearts Project. What do you do? Who do you help?
So the Heroic Hearts Project is a registered nonprofit in the U.S. We also have branches in the U.K. and Canada, but it originally started in the U.S. I myself am a military veteran, and the express purpose of the organization is really to expand the knowledge and education around psychedelic treatments and therapies, as well as connecting veterans to these treatments. So the tricky aspect comes because psychedelics in the U.S. are still illegal, and as well as many other countries. But at the same time, they're also showing great results for treating mental health and also some physical ailments. So veterans have a choice because the current treatment modalities are proving to be not effective for a huge portion of them. So a lot of them are going overseas. They're going to Mexico, Latin America, Peru, to go to countries where these are legal. And so that's where Heroic Hearts steps in. We have a program, a many-month program that prepares the veteran, connects them with vetted retreat centers, and then follows up with something called integration of hopefully they have an amazing, profound experience. But then that's only the start of the work. The rest of the work is, what are they going to do with those realizations, the newfound perspectives, and how are they going to change their lives effectively so they don't fall back into old patterns and so they can really hit the ground running? So we've been operational for over 6 years now, and as you mentioned, we've served more than about 500 vets at this point, just really putting them through this program. We've seen some miraculous stories of, you know, overcoming PTSD, suicide ideation, depression, addictions, anxiety.
So I heard you say that there's a pre-process and a post-process. I know you have an integration coach on staff. That was one of the things I was checking out on your website. And I think when people are talking about compounds like psychedelics, it's really easy to focus on the psychedelics themselves and lose that beginning and end piece. Will you talk about the importance of both the preparation going into it and that integration afterwards?
Absolutely. And I'm glad you asked that, because that's one of the most important discussions around psychedelics, because inevitably, I think the vast majority of the population, if they haven't already, are going to hear more and more about psychedelics saving my life, psychedelics healing this. And so there's a risk there that when people hear that, then they're just like, oh, well, if I just take a handful of this random psychedelic and go to my basement, then everything will be a-okay. But you have to approach these with respect and understanding that they are very powerful substances. And if you don't have the proper setting and the proper preparation, then you are putting yourself up for risk of potentially making some of the traumas worse, or just putting yourself in a very vulnerable state that you don't have the tools to effectively manage. And so that was the reason for our program, or for creating this program, because when I went to Peru, I'm glad I did and had already developed tools to make the most of it, but I was also just kind of going there and hoping for the best. There's no preparation, there's no aftercare. It's pretty much you're on your own. And so I could have had a much more successful experience had these guardrails been in place, had this expertise that we provide been in place. And so that's what one of those things I want everybody to understand, that we are in an amazing time because we are finally understanding and allowing substances that are having extremely good effects, especially in comparison to SSRIs and some other medications, for a lot of people. But it's not necessarily for everybody, and it needs to be done with proper intention and respect. And so, for instance, with our program, we do 4 to 6 weeks of preparation. And within that, it's getting people in the right mind frame. It's eating healthier. There's a specific diet, making sure they're off certain medications, talking about intentions, talking about mindfulness, breath work, all these important tools. So by the time they actually set foot on the retreat, a lot of them have actually processed a lot of the things that they're going through, because it's really sort of a deviation from their normal distracted life. And they're finally looking at, oh, how am I reacting to the situations? What's coming up? Why is that coming up? So a lot of people even find that the preparation cycle is almost as therapeutic getting into it. And they're like, oh, I learned a lot about myself, cutting out, you know, my addiction to caffeine and alcohol and all this. And like you mentioned, we have what we call integration coaches. So it's peer support. We actually have a team of about 30, and Jared on our team manages them. So they go through a certification process, pretty rigorous 3-month course. They're by no means therapists, nor do they say they are, but they are this peer support, and they are equipped to handle it in that capacity of just connecting with a veteran, talking to them, helping them down pathways where they have more tools to better understand themselves. And so then when the person gets home, like I said, the integration, and a lot of people say that's one of the most important spots because it's the rest of your life, right? And it's challenging, the psychedelic experience itself, and you do come away from that oftentimes like just ready to tackle the world, feeling hope, feeling love. But if you do not make the proper changes in your life, then a lot of the traumatic things that we create in our life will come back. So the thing about trauma is we reinforce it, right? We come into these relationships which are toxic. We create systems and routines that just sort of reinforce our unhappy states. So if you don't break free from those, then you're going to find yourself in the similar sort of ruts and the similar sort of blockages that you did before. And so there is this huge window where, one, your brain has increased plasticity from the psychedelic, but two, you're almost recharged. You have new hope, new energy. And so that's where we really reinforce that people use that to the best benefit of creating these small, I don't know if you've read Atomic Habits, but similar sort of thing of these small approachable habits that will then have much more profound effects in a year's time, in 10 years time. And so that's why this whole thing is so important. That's why I do believe our program to be one of the most effective. You can get lucky and have a big dose of psilocybin, mushrooms, and it resolves a lot of your issues. But you could also be unlucky without any of this. And we get people that come to us and they're really struggling because they went to a spot that wasn't vetted, or they did themselves and it just really left them open-ended. So these are great treatments, but they should be treated with respect and with intention.
I appreciate so much that that's a part of your program, where we're starting from a place of respect, we're starting from a place of intentionality and carrying that all the way through the experience, right? If the arc of the story has a beginning, a middle, and an end, not just focusing on that climax of the story, but like being able to carry people all the way through. And here at Mudwater, we're a huge fan of Atomic Habits. We just had a book club. It's that kind of slow change, low harm approach where it's actually sustainable because you're building it slowly over time in a way that you can actually integrate. So I totally hear you on the Atomic Habits part of that. And when you were talking about your integration coach, I think you said his name was Jared.
Correct.
One of the things I appreciate is when somebody's coming in, not necessarily as the expert, but as a co-creator and a holder of the experience with you. So they're not coming in and telling you what you should be doing. They're just holding you through what's happening for you. And I know one of the parts of your program, it's not just getting veterans access to these psychedelic treatments. It's also then allowing them to turn into mentors for future people who are having these experiences. So can you talk about the importance of community, like not just having this as an individual experience that you then go home and apply to your personal life, but how this then spreads to the rest of the community?
Yeah, so one of the things, and the reason with the coaching that we think it's so important, and that's the first step of this community, that I think we wouldn't be in the spot if there weren't a lot of issues in the mental health system. It's not just the fact that we don't have the right substance, right? It's not just the fact that, you know, most people can't afford a therapist. There's a lot of systematic issues within this, and I think this is a great opportunity to reassess and create new systems. I think one of those systems is this lack of peer support, effective peer support. Right now, we kind of have this understanding that, hey, go see a therapist. If I have any sort of issue, you know, from 0 to 10 that I'm struggling with, the only line of connection is see a therapist or your friend who may or may not be helpful at teaching you that. But peer support with the proper training can be remarkably effective and much more cost effective for sure. And they've actually done studies about this. And it makes sense. We're communal animals. And so back in the day before there was therapists, we would have our issues with elders or with other people that were, you know, uniquely talented at active listening and hearing the people out. And so giving these veterans that ability to connect with other veterans that have been there, but then are also having that training so that they can push them forward in terms of the conversation. If the facilitator is taking up most of the call talking, then they're not a good coach, right? They should be empowering the person with active questions, active listening. And then also from a veteran standpoint, this is a thing that a lot of therapists have trouble with, is there's a trust. A lot of veterans go to their therapist and they just don't have the trust, and they kind of get caught into these ruts of like, oh, you don't know, how are you going to help me when you've never been to war? And a lot of that is sort of trauma, you know, walls, but you do have to be able to get past that. And that's where this veteran peer support, where they feel like they can be vulnerable, they feel like this person understands them, and it makes them feel a bit more comfortable. And so the beauty about veterans, and a lot of people in general, but veterans are inherently people of service. And so almost the first thing they want to do when they've been suffering for decades and been on all sorts of medication, and for the first time in 10, 20 years, they feel even a glimmer of hope. They feel love. They feel, one person recently said, this is the first time I felt emotions in 20 years, which in itself is super profound. The first thing they more often than not want to do is, how can I help? How can I help other vets? How can I bring other people into this? Because I want to share that, which is such a remarkable thing. And sometimes we have to like stop them where it's like in the middle of the ceremony, like, how can I help? Like, hey, just finish your ceremony. You know, there's time, you know, just calm down a little bit. But that's why we provide this ecosystem pathway where if they do want to and they do the work, we give them time to, you got to help yourself first. You know, help yourself, help your family, then you can help the community. And then if they do that and they do the work for a while and they're still doing well, we will provide them a scholarship to get certified so then they can come in. And then they can also earn some money, some sort of livelihood where they're giving back, they're helping other veterans, but they're also not doing it at the expense of themselves. They're not running themselves thin, right? And so creating these ecosystems is so key and so powerful, where the vast majority of people cannot afford a therapist, and especially underserved communities. And so we need to change that dynamic. And I do think peer support is one of those ways that we can really tackle the massive mental health issue, not only the veteran community, but we saw that especially after COVID, how universal these issues are. And I think they're just going to get worse. And so that's one of those pipelines. We're also creating other training for facilitation or liaison. So essentially at retreats, people who are there to help out while people are going through these experiences, help out either the healers or the practitioners that are doing it, and so that they can be there, what people call holding space. So again, it's one of those things of, you need to have a presence there, but you also don't want to be the dominating presence. You're just there to help the person go through if they're having a really hard time. Sometimes help, you know, just, hey, breathe, hey, just follow your heart, all that kind of stuff. So a few different pathways for them to get more involved. And it's beautiful too, because one, that helps the coach continue their training, because then one, it holds them accountable, because if they're preaching it, they're more inclined to follow it themselves. But two, they also see, it's much easier to see our own issues in other people, right? Like, we tend to be kind of dumb when it's ourselves, when you're like, oh, I do that too. And so it helps them push forward as well. And it fills that sort of service gap where a lot of veterans, when they come out of the service, they go into corporate America, they do this job, and they just lack that sense of doing something beyond themselves. And so it fills so many different gaps. And it's just remarkable to see how excited the coaches are to help out. We have this whole chat, and they swap notes. And even to the point where we've consulted with VAs, different hospitals who are looking to the future, and they know that at some point they're going to have psychedelic treatments available. And so they're talking to our coaches and to our staff, like, okay, well, what should we expect with veterans? How does this work? What do you experience? And so it really is leading the way in a lot of this. And, you know, and at the same time, it's healing, it's healthy. And so that's a beautiful thing of, like any other ecosystem, when you create these things that feed into themselves and just make richer, more diverse, more stable environments. And on the community level, I think we're severely missing that in modern times.
I can feel the diversity of your approach, how it feels much more like an organic garden than this kind of mechanical, linear, isolated, like sanitized way of dealing with things, right? You're like, we're actually going to have a multifold approach where everything is feeding the other things. And one of the things you mentioned, like, I imagine that when somebody, I don't have any military experience. I come from a military family. So my dad, my aunt, my nana, my grandfather, like, they were all in military positions. But once somebody has been of service, they found what their service is, and then that service changes or ends for some reason. Like, most of us are looking for purpose, right? Most of us are looking for a way to be of service, even if we're not necessarily tracking that. When we're in service or of service, we feel more grounded, we feel more like ourselves, we feel our purpose. I can imagine then losing that or having that change in some way would be particularly heartbreaking until you find what the next thing is. And I think that's so beautiful that the people that you're working with are going, and now this is the next layer of how I can be of service to my community and how I can actually share my gifts with the world. And recognizing that these are people that have already given so much, and then they have this impulse to give more. And one of the things that your work deals with is how veterans have been failed by the current veteran affairs system. Can you talk about how that system has failed and what you offer as an alternative?
The clearest example of that is the very fact that veterans by the thousands are having to go to other countries to get life-saving mental health care. That fact, that statistic in itself should make anybody turn their head and ask, like, why is this going on? What's wrong here? And I can dive into all the other statistics. None of them make the government look good. And this is not to demonize the VA. There's some amazing people. We also have to understand that the systems that we're working with. The VA is not going to be an innovator, no matter what we do to it. It's not going to be this, you know, maverick, leading the edge sort of institution. It's a giant healthcare provider, one of the biggest in the world, if not the biggest. And it has to serve all these countless veterans. And we just got done with 20 years, done, quote unquote, with 20 years of war, with massive amounts of veterans with PTSD and all sorts of other issues. It's a slow-moving giant, and so we can only expect it to do so much there. But that doesn't bring anybody off the hook. We did just get done with 20 years of war, and we had no problem funding the surges, the bases, the equipment. But when somebody asks for a little bit more help with healthcare or with mental health, then it's crickets. And we're even seeing that now, where one of the first things on the chopping block with the budget is funding to the VA, funding for health, by a pretty substantial amount. And how does that make sense? Of, thank you for your service 20 years. I'm sorry, we can't help. The other biggest thing is, I think most people have heard at this point of the veteran suicide rate, which is the most emblematic thing of the failure of treating our veterans, where the number is very hard to track down, but estimates anywhere from 17 to 44 a day commit suicide, veterans, and anywhere on that scale is too many. And it's what we do know is it's well above the national population by sometimes factors of two times to five times, depending. Women tend to have higher rates there, but also the very fact that more veterans from the global war on terrorism have died by suicide than they died in combat, by at least a factor of 10. Again, and the VA, despite billions of dollars of funding to date, has not been effective. And again, that doesn't mean we should cut the funding there, because that's clearly not going to make the problem any better. But we're dealing with lack of accountability. We're dealing with people who just don't seem to be interested because it doesn't concern them directly in the form of politicians. And we have these substances that are stigmatized that make people have flashbacks to the 70s and they get scared by that. But they're clearly showing benefit, or they're clearly showing something. And they're above and beyond worthwhile to investigate at the very least. But it's been nearly impossible to research it. We were finally breaking through it, but up until recently, there's really no government funding of any of this. Substances like MDMA, which is the chemical in ecstasy, not a traditional psychedelic, but gets lumped in, that had to go through, that's going through just finished third stage trials of the FDA, showed miraculous rates of recovery for treatment-resistant PTSD. 67% had no PTSD afterwards, which is a huge, huge jump from anything else from SSRIs or the current medical treatment. So a huge jump, and also on the hardest of the hardest cases. So pretty substantial. Likely going to be prescribable in the next year or so once it goes through the FDA. Also a Schedule I drug, which is why it's been so hard. The all of that, or at least the vast majority of the hundreds of millions of dollars that went to get it to the third stage trials, was publicly funded. It was through nonprofits, not publicly funded. It was privately funded through crowdsourcing, through donations, not from the government. And even though it was pretty clear early on that this was a breakthrough in PTSD treatment, PTSD, the poster child of what veterans are going through. Again, crickets on the government side. And so that's what's so frustrating here, is that a lot of politicians are on both sides are more than willing to say, I support the troops, are more than willing to use veterans and the flag for political gain. They're more than willing to send soldiers to these conflicts. But then when these soldiers actually need help, when these soldiers need just the littlest bit of their attention, they're not getting that. And that is something that is tragic, that is something that needs to change, that is something that every politician up there should be held accountable for and should be made to answer to.
I absolutely stand by you in that, and the virtue signaling of politicians who say, I support the troops, or stand by the flag for the photo op. That, alongside of those horrifying statistics that you just rattled off, it's absolutely unacceptable. And I'm so glad that you're in the fight to change things around all of this. And recognizing that there is this stigma around these substances, right? And a lot of that stigma has come from the war on drugs, from political campaigns, from this idea of wanting to control these substances for whatever reason. Everyone's got lots of opinions about what those reasons are. And since one of your goals is to counter the stigma that's associated with psychedelics and help change the laws limiting access to psychedelics as therapeutics, when you meet a veteran who's interested in having these experiences, or if there's a veteran who's listening to this, who's interested in having these experiences, but has hesitation because of how we've been culturally trained to see these compounds as dangerous, they're not legal in a lot of places, what would you say to them?
I would say to that veteran, have hesitation because it's serious work, but don't have hesitation because these are quote unquote illegal, or you've heard urban legends about them. And it's also not our job, and we tell every veteran that comes to our program and our staff, we're not here to convince people to take psychedelics. We're not here to push them on anybody. We're here to be a vessel for when they are ready for it. And we're here to educate them about the potential benefits. We also don't want to oversell it. We're not saying, you know, one size fits all and 100% success rate. But we do see pretty high success rates, and we do see that if a person puts in the work, that more often than not, they will get at least a modicum of healing, relief, or insight into what the person needs to do in the future, which in itself can be huge. Just even a little glimmer of hope for a lot of these guys and gals is tremendous. And so that's where we stand is, I would say if you have been suffering and the treatments that you've been going through haven't worked, then look into this. Read our website. You can read How to Change Your Mind by Michael Pollan or the Netflix series made after that. There's a lot of great information in there. There's a lot of great books. I mean, some of them might delve more into a little bit on the woo-woo side, which might throw some veterans off, but there's also a lot of great science and research articles. So do your own research. You should go into this feeling comfortable with what you're doing. Everybody that goes through it's going to be a little bit apprehensive, again, because they're doing serious work, but we want it to be their decision. And so we're just there to provide them. But I do think that if you even want to heal a little bit, if that's, you know, sometimes people get caught up in their own trauma and say they're fine, and, you know, sometimes it takes a little bit longer. But if you're just tired of suffering, of struggling, of being sad or being angry, these tools are showing to be effective, and that's being proven out by Johns Hopkins University, University of Texas, most of the major Stanford, most of the major universities are on board with this. Some of the smartest researchers and academics are on board with this. And so ask why that is the case. They're not just wasting their time. So give it a chance. Try to suppress. Do yourself a favor. Try to suppress any stigmas or horror stories. But then also do it right. You know, like go to it and do a proper program, ours, or there's others out there as well. Or go to a vetted retreat spot.
So I really appreciate this because we're talking about the government is limiting access to these substances, and you're not doing this full pendulum swing from, oh, the government's limiting, so now we're going to push these substances. It feels a little bit more like a buffet table when you're like, I just want people to have access to all the options so they can actually make choices for themselves. And we're trying to make more of these options available for the people who are called to them.
Absolutely. And it's more tools, the better. And that's what these are. Psychedelics are tools just like anything else. And currently in our toolbox, we have very few tools. The VA does talk therapy and a variety of SSRIs or psychiatric medicines for some people that can be what they need, you know. But there's a huge percentage from the VA's own statistics, about 2/3 walk away still having some form of PTSD. So that's a huge number, especially when, from their estimates, more than 600,000 veterans from the last 20 years of war have been diagnosed with PTSD, which goes into millions when we bring in the other engagements of wars over the generations. So you're starting to get huge numbers of veterans that, if you say 2/3 of those are still struggling, we clearly don't have enough tools. And so whether it's psychedelics, whether it's something else that's effective, you know, by all means, we need more options. We need something that might work for somebody, might not work for somebody else. And so MDMA, hallucinogenics, they're all showing effects in different ways. But then also something called EMDR or transcranial magnets have been showing effects. There's all sorts of different treatments out there. And veterans should have access, because right now, for the vast majority of them, they have to pay out of pocket, or some VAs are a little bit forward leaning, but it's not universal for all the VAs. And so that's really what we're trying to incorporate here. And then also one of the other factors, and this kind of goes back to that community piece, is more care for the spouses, because one, that's the first line of support for the veteran, the husbands or wives back home, but they also have secondary PTSD from dealing with that. They also have their own mental trauma from, you know, either from their past or from being in that sort of lifestyle where the spouse is overseas and risking their life. They're maybe dealing with their PTSD as well in a variety of different ways that are generally unhealthy. And so if one side is healing and the other is not, then you're just going to have more friction. And again, you're going to get back into these trauma routines. And so that's, you know, we recently merged with an organization called the Hope Project, started by a veteran spouse, exactly that, to have a more family dynamic, as well as, so the spouses get coaching, but they also get access to their own retreats. But anybody of the family, if they just want to learn or hear about why the spouse is going to these retreats, we do some info sessions so that they can be better support and better understanding of what's going on.
That feels huge. Again, like not just focusing on treating one individual in a single moment, a single session, or maybe two sessions, but not just like focusing on that singularity, but really this web of care that's being created. Because of course the veteran is going to have this trauma. Of course the spouse is going to be responding to the worry and the trauma. Then all of the people who have been supporting that spouse, who's been supporting the veteran, I mean, this ripples out, and this is really just like emphasizing the fact that it takes the village. Like, we need to be able to like take care of the entire community if we actually want everybody to be able to experience that level of healing. It can't be this isolated person or moment. It's this extended process. And I just am so excited to hear that y'all are holding all of these pieces.
And not to mention generational trauma too. I mean, most people already have this stereotype of, you know, the veteran from Vietnam coming home and, you know, being pretty messed up by their experiences. And then the kids, you know, sometimes abuse or sometimes have absentee or sometimes are just in this like chaotic sort of situation. Then those kids have their own trauma, right? They have trouble adjusting or have addiction tendencies or what have you. And then if they have kids, like it's this continual link. And they've actually shown on like an epigenetic side that these kind of stresses and these sort of traumas can actually be inherited on a chromosomal level of how genes are expressed. So this is a huge sort of factor that if we're just kind of looking at it on a reductionist scale, which is what mental health and a lot of medical care has been of, it's always been sort of this like Lego system of like, hey, if we just get the right block and the right piece and we put it right there, then the whole set's going to be complete. Or you have to kind of look at the whole everything of what's going on. It's much more complex issue, especially on the family dynamics. And we've seen that a lot with veterans, which is one of the most beautiful things, where they come home after their experience and they tell us of this was the first time that they really enjoyed being with their kid, or they felt present with their kid, or they felt vulnerable with their kid. This one Green Beret sniper that we served, he told a story afterwards, and it was just a simple story of him in the morning with his kid making pancakes, and he was just absolutely enjoying it, and he never remembered feeling so happy. And where before he was like very regimented and military, where like, okay, we're done, we got to get to the bus and otherwise we're gonna miss school, and like just kind of being in that very straight lace, this time he was like, yeah, it doesn't matter, I'm enjoying having time with my kid. Worst case scenario, miss the bus, we'll drive him there and then we'll get to spend more time, you know. And so it's a simple story, but from that kid's perspective, when he's 5 years old, that's going to shape his emotional availability. That's going to shape his, you know, comfort, his safety net, his resilience, so many different things, to where then that trauma ends right there potentially. And then that kid can have a much healthier life and pass that on. And so the ripples of effective mental health, whether it's coming from psychedelics or other causes, is just, it expands out. And so I do think, again, like I said, so many different systems that need to be rethought, but moving from this reductionist to more holistic, which I know is a loaded term, has baggage, but it is the case of you have to look at the body, the whole organism. You have to look at the family, the whole ecosystem, because, you know, you can not have PTSD, but if you're eating McDonald's every day and, you know, you're just watching violent shows all the time and are always on social media, you're probably going to be not in the best mental health you're probably not going to have the best mental health. You need to eat healthy. You need to exercise. You need to ingest positive media if you do. There's so many different factors that we really limit ourselves and do a disservice. And so with medicine, I think that's one of those things that needs to change, you know, and that's one of those things Mudwater's doing, right? Of having a healthier morning beverage or drink beverage that can have a lot of other effects besides just filling that routine and that the energy capacity.
That was beautiful. Talk about integration, not just across the psychedelic experience, but intergenerationally, like this integration, this healing trauma, intergenerationally. That's so profound. And you're right. Mudwater is absolutely committed to a holistic overhaul, not just this one piece. You know, yeah, like we're a drinks company for sure. And we're also doing this podcast with you. And we also write these articles. And like, we're also trying to engage the community in this way because we know, like, I mean, let's be honest, if you change one thing, other things are going to change as well. But if you're consciously changing multiple things in your life, you're just going to be so much more successful because you're priming the environment, right? You're setting the environment up for success rather than having an experience that then you drop it into an environment where that experience isn't sustainable, but really laying that groundwork. So it's like, oh, when I step into my life, all of these different pieces of my life are supporting these changes and choices that I'm saying I want to make.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, it goes to nature. And I'll keep using this word because I think it's the best example of it, the ecosystem. The reason when you have ecosystems, they tend to be these things in nature that are much more resilient than anything else. You know, so you have the rainforest, and although certain species may die or what have you, the whole ecosystem itself is very strong. It takes a lot for it to change. But then if you get to this tipping point, then it just kind of cascades down, right? Because there is that point where it is interdependent. And if you start killing off too much, as opposed to what we see with sort of uniform crops or lumber mills, where it's all the same species and they're all the same type, they tend to be very ecologically dead because it doesn't allow for different animals, it doesn't allow for different plants and all that. And it's much more susceptible to blights, to bacteria, fungus, viruses, because it only takes one of those species to mutate to get one, and then it just spreads everything else. Whereas if you have a new virus in the rainforest, it might hit, you know, a couple trees or this or that, but it's not going to just wipe out the whole rainforest, right? And so it's the same thing with our lives and our habits and our patterns, where on one side, if you're in a trauma state, it tends to feed into itself, where you're depressed, so you drink more, you take drugs to escape, that, you know, messes up your gut microbiome, you know, you gain weight or you're less likely to go to the gym, and then you're out of shape, and then that also makes your depression worse, and then you're probably hanging out more at certain spots, and so then your crowd is reinforcing that, and then can lead to financial trouble if you get more depressed, more anxious, and it just feeds on itself to where at a certain point you're at this irredeemable spot. You're at the spot that's so hard to dig out because if you're in debt and you're out of weight and you just have no motivation, like it takes a lot to get out of there. But in the reverse, if you start building these patterns, these routines, kind of going back to that atomic habits where you just wake up and you know you're doing this and you're doing this and you incorporate healthy habits to make that pattern, then it becomes a much more sustainable sort of thing. It becomes sort of a self-sustaining system that little by little you improve your life, but it becomes a little bit more resilient that things can't shake it. You might have a bad week or you might get a cold, but then you'll hop back on because that's the container you created. So it's the same thing with all these healing things of really, we have to think outside the individual. It's not just overcoming PTSD. It's not just overcoming depression. We can have a person without PTSD, but they're still not happy, right? So the question is, how do we, the mental health issues are almost like the barriers. So let's remove the barrier, but then let's also provide the avenues of success to where then they can actually thrive afterwards.
Amazing. And you're talking about this ecosystem that has this richness to it, that has this resiliency to it. And you're a big part of that, of creating this ecosystem, of tracking these different pieces of the ecosystem. And I know you are also an ultra runner. And people who have been listening to this podcast by this point know I'm all for soothing strategies. And I also deeply believe in intensity practices. And there's this principle in Aikido, which is this Japanese martial art, right? Where there's something massive to be gained just past what you think your limit is. On the other side of your limit, there's all of this knowledge, all of this awareness. And I'm curious, does your ultra running play into your ability to hold space, your spaciousness for the Heroic Hearts Project, for the vision that you have for veterans? Do you feel like that intensity practice is what allows you to hold all those horrifying statistics that you mentioned and have the bigger vision and be tracking this ecodiversity and this ecosystem? Does that help?
I think so. I mean, it definitely is one of my mental health escapes or mental health releases that I try to incorporate in my life, and it kind of keeps things together. For instance, if I have those on the and by no means am I great at it, but I can keep going. I'm just never the fastest, but it's something I enjoy doing, especially different destinations. But for one, it holds me more accountable because, you know, you have to train, otherwise you're going to be struggling a lot. And so then you have to sort of incorporate your life around those sort of events. And it gives you that target, that goal, that accomplishment after it. The ultra circuits have their own unique community of pretty amazing people. And so when you're there, it's just as much about the community as it is about the race and hanging out. And I often do like these multi-day ones in the middle of nowhere. I was just in Finland in the Arctic Circle, and so it was over the course of many days. So after you do your leg of the race, you're just around a fire, tending to your feet, swapping stories, meeting some amazing people. So it's the community there too. And what I explained, because for a lot of people, they're like, oh, you did this. It was like, you know, a 150-mile race. And they're like, oh, that's stupid. That sounds destructive. And so for me, and I think it's, everybody has to find their release. Everybody has to find their capacity. And, you know, it can come in simpler forms like breath work or meditation, or, you know, some people for going to church or going swimming or what have you. And for me, I try to incorporate some of those things. But this, I think just because of how my brain works and the high intensity and the high capacity I'm always at, I also need sort of the higher release of it. And so with these longer races, what people need to understand is that no matter what, everybody's going to be hurting at some point. You know, there's nobody that's just going to feel spry, super spry after running so many miles. But it's more of how you deal with the pain when it comes. Obviously, you want to train to minimize that. And you have to, you know, do the right things. But there's always going to be this threshold where your body's in pain or your mind's racing. And it becomes pretty interesting because at first it's hard because you're working against yourself. But then once you start understanding it and you get into this kind of flow with it, you realize it starts to simplify things. So one, the beauty of it, like especially within the middle of nowhere, is all you have to do during that day is get from point A to point B and just make sure your feet are good and you eat, right? There's nothing else. There's no emails. There's no calls. So it's a very simple life. And you're just there in nature, which is in itself healing. And you go to bed early, you wake up early, and you're just drinking and water and going through it. But two, when you get into that pain state, you realize how much your brain like fights against it, or how much your brain has these sort of over nervous sort of dynamics, where if you're running some sort of pain in your knee, then your brain's like, oh, focus on this. Like, what's going on here? And then it starts worrying of like, oh, what happens if this destroys your knee, or what happens if this causes this issue 10 years down the line, or what have you. So it's like looking for distraction. It's looking for you. It's looking to almost like meditation, these thoughts that are just looking for you to grab onto them, support them to take your attention. And then it's not like your whole body's in pain, but it like moves around your body of like, you'll be first focusing on your knee, and then your foot, and then your toe, and then your shoulders will be sore, and it just goes in this loop. And once you figure that out, you can quiet it, almost similar to a meditation practice, where you no longer grab on to those things vying for your attention, and you just let it process through itself. And then you can just sort of, you can be at peace just running, just going, being in nature. Occasionally I'll grab your attention again, but if you just focus on the running, on your breathing, then you find this sort of almost like more peaceful zen zone going through it. And for me, that's the benefit of it, of getting to that brain state, getting to that way, and also just that stress energy, that pain energy, it does relieve a lot. Not in a masochistic way, maybe a little bit, but in its own sort of way, where you just feel tired but almost rejuvenated towards the end of the whole race, especially once you finished it. Everybody's happy and you feel like you accomplished stuff. So there's so many positive mental health benefits that I think come from just that whole experience that I really enjoy, and I really like doing it. I do think it keeps me in a positive flow, and especially able to deal with this very heavy work where we get, you know, 5+ applications of veterans in desperate need for care. And, you know, we do our best, but we can't help all of them, or some of them are just in so dire need that, you know, this might not be the best bet. And so, you know, my whole team, we encourage them to go do their own mental health retreats, psychedelic retreats, yoga retreats, whatever their own thing is, to shed the weight of this heavy work, this worthwhile work, but heavy work.
This question of how do you handle it when the hurt arrives? Because I think a lot of people have this idealism that I'm going to make myself resilient enough, strong enough, smart enough, capable enough, prepared enough that I'll be able to keep all of the hurt out. And we know that's idealism. The hurt's going to come one way or another. And part of the way that we're able to choose how we respond when hurt arrives is by having some kind of practice of noticing how we handle when hurt arrives. So whether people are like you, where they're doing this ultra running, this super high intensity practice, whether people are doing some kind of cold plunge practice, and, you know, Andrew Huberman talks about this, like, quiet mind moving limbs, where you don't just go completely still, you make the mind still and you keep the body moving through that initial response of, I don't want to be here, I don't like this, is this bad for me? Even down to a simple yoga class. So I take class with an instructor whose name is Tani Janae, who says that the yoga starts the minute you want to drop out of the yoga pose. The minute you want to leave, when your muscles start burning, when you start to get tired, that's when the yoga starts. How do you respond to that moment?
Yeah,
appreciate that.
In the military called it mental fortitude or resilience, and doing challenging things. When you do those, it makes other things easier. I remember in Ranger school, one of the things we had to do as a Ranger, and it's a 3-month course, leadership course, and generally through the course of, over the duration of it, food deprivation, sleep deprivation. I went during winter, so essentially shivering for the full 3 months. And there's, I forget who originally came up with it, but there's this sort of theory of circles. And depending on the stress and what's going on in your life, it's the focus of how big that circle can be. So when it's really challenging, for instance, those days in Ranger school where you wake up, you're shivering, you're cold, you're absolutely exhausted because your pack weighs 100 pounds and you're doing these like multi-kilometer navigations over the mountains. And instead of thinking all the way to the end of like, oh, can I make it to tonight? You have to make your circle smaller. Okay, can I make it to the next meal? Can I make it to the next stop? Okay, if that's too much, then you make that circle a little bit smaller. Can I make it for another few minutes? Okay, I can do that. So let's do that and then make it for the next few minutes. If you get to the next spot, then you can kind of expand your circle depending on where it's at. And it's this focus sort of thing that if you, like, especially on the Ranger School front, if I told you everything you're going to have to do at the get-go, the vast majority would be like, there's no way. That's not possible for me to do it. And you're going to psych yourself out and make it impossible or drop out. But if you just take it the day at a time, the meal at a time, then a lot more becomes possible. And I think that's the mental fortitude that some of these more challenging things, or like you said, with yoga, it's your brain wants the comfort and wants the easiness, but to build that strength, that's the benefit of putting it in these positive, stressful environments. And when you do that more, it allows you to expand those circles, be more comfortable with bigger circles, to where with these races, I know it's going to be painful, but I also can look to the end and plan. I'm like, yeah, I can do that, but let me be conscientious here.
I think that's such a gift you just offered people. We have atomic habits. We have micro interventions, but atomic habits and micro interventions, they're a little abstract, right? I mean, James Clear does a good job of getting into the nitty gritty, but that visualization of the circle, just make your circle smaller. I feel like that's something people can walk away with, like a strong visualization of like, how can I make my circle smaller right now so I can do what the next thing is that I need to do? That's powerful. Thank you for that share. I hadn't heard that before.
Yeah, thank you. It's also like in like disaster situations when everything's going wrong, it's like, okay, what can I resolve right now? You know, everything's horrible, but okay, can I fix this? Okay, I can fix that. Let me expand. Or you're just super overwhelmed. Okay, what is possible for me to do right now? Let me just do that. Okay, can I answer this email? Okay, let's focus on the next thing. And that's served me pretty well, just getting you in that calm spot and just also not letting the bigger stuff distract you or don't focus on it.
It's interesting, right? Because psychedelics, we're talking about this neuroplasticity, and psychedelics allow that kind of lantern consciousness, and then also the importance of that spotlight consciousness, like, oh, I'm going to be able to hold all of the pieces simultaneously right now. Now I'm just going to be able to focus here. And that ability to move in and out of those two states of consciousness consciously, like depending on what the moment requires, feels really important.
And it also, I mean, it's the same sort of challenge dynamic, which is why, again, why we don't push people, because it can be one of, we've had veterans, you know, with multiple deployments, and this can still be one of the hardest things they've ever done, which makes sense because they've held in all this trauma for years and oftentimes from childhood, and they're very good at holding it in and compartmentalizing. And what psychedelics allow us to do is be ultra sensitive, and it comes up. So, you know, if anxiety or depression is your thing, then the first few ceremonies, that's going to be your world. This world that you're creating on the inside and destroying your body with is it's almost essentially saying, okay, you wanna tear yourself up. I will give you the most uncomfortable pain experience that you are creating as a manifestation, and people will struggle through that. But it's that same sort of resilience. If they get through that, then they understand, hey, okay, I don't want to do this to myself anymore. I'm done with this. Let's think happy thoughts. Let's go. But it's that friction that sometimes you just have to go through that until you realize, okay, this is not what I want. But you have to understand that on a deep level. But then that challenge too, it also makes you much more resilient. So you come from these experiences like, oh, that was horrible, or that was really challenging. Oh, I just have my child is acting up. I can handle this any day, you know?
There's that moment where you have to blend with somebody, right? Where somebody goes, "This is what I want." And you go, "Okay, I'm going to meet you where you are and I'm going to blend with you and I'm going to give you some of that." And then they go, "Okay, like I've had enough of what I want." And you go, "Great. Can I show you the other choices that are available now too? And maybe you'd like to walk this path a little bit."
Yeah, absolutely.
So, what was the moment that you knew you had to bring ayahuasca to veterans?
It was more of an obligation than a moment of epiphany. It was coming from that, and I didn't tell anybody. And essentially, I walked away from my job. It was a one-way ticket to Peru just because I knew the toxic bubble that I had created in Florida was not serving me, and I needed to just clean slate and figure something out. Otherwise, it would have ended up poorly or badly. And so, went through this experience again. The reason I started the foundation because there was no veteran group or organization talking about this or providing these tools. And so, I kind of had to hit the walls of, you know, like there's a little bit of talk integration, but not guardrails or anything. And so, stumble a little bit, you know, regress a little bit, but overall was doing a lot better and talking to friends. And more often than not, just had people who they're like, yeah, that's crazy, but if it works, it works. I kept hearing that of, you know, you don't always choose the tools you have, but you got to adapt and overcome, to use the military term. And at the same time, I had already had kept hearing people I'd served with, you know, die by suicide, or talking to people that were on that downward spiral, and just became of like, hey, I wish I'd known about this earlier. I wish I didn't struggle as long as I did. And why don't these people know about it? Well, we need to bridge this gap, like at least one more tool, right? I'm not pushing them, but they deserve to know that there's something out there, right? They deserve to know that there is something that they can turn to. And so that really was this question that came of like, hey, could this potentially help people that you know? And the answer was yes. And then two, given your background, could you potentially make something out of this and make it successful? And that was also yes. And so then it was kind of almost this like, oh shit moment of like, oh, now I have to do this. And so then it was like almost dragging me of like, you know, like anybody else, I want to get out of the military and have a good job and good money and all that. The last thing I want to do is start a nonprofit, which lives up to its name. But I'm very fortunate to be in that. It's purpose-driven work. And it was that obligation of sometimes you're handed this and you can either choose to do something about it because you have the power to, or ignore it. But I think that would stay with you if it would stay with me if I did.
If people wanted to find out more about the Heroic Hearts Project, if people wanted to be in this fight for veterans to have effective psychotherapy, what can they do? Where can they get more information?
So our website is heroicheartsproject.org, the three words, heroicheartsproject.org. And then we have Instagram as our main social media account. So you can sign up for that. If you're a veteran and you're looking into going through this, we have our application on our website, so you can go there. If you're a spouse, we also provide the spousal coaching and retreats there through the Hope Project, so you can go to the Hope Project and sign up right now. If you're somebody that just wants to help, we are a nonprofit. We are registered. Money, donations is always the best way. It costs about $5,000 per veteran, and there's literally thousands of veterans on our wait list. And so we need support from people, and great companies like Mud Water are already donating to us. So if you really want to help, this is the most effective way to help veterans, I promise you. And donations are always the best way. If you're not financially able, we do have an ambassador program too. And so just helping us share messages, helping us make new connections, all of that, whatever way you want to help, I'm sure we can figure out something. So the best bet is our website. Check it out. If you have questions, it's easy to go on there and ask them.
So go to that website, y'all. Hit that donate button. Spread the love. Share the word. Help Jesse out in this incredible work that he's doing. Jesse, thank you so much for being part of this conversation. That was absolutely wonderful getting to talk to you about this.
Yeah, Mutual, thank you so much for the platform, Sarah. I do really enjoy this conversation, and thanks to Mudwater for the support, the platform, and then also the donations as well. It really lead companies like this that really don't have to, and that are putting their neck out there should be leading the way. So I hope that resonates with your audience as well.
Mudwater cares. They really do. All right. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Sarah.